Just go ahead and stand. We're going to sing some songs together.
There's nothing worth more than ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves. My heart becomes free. My shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be over.
Till heaven came to live with me. Good morning, everyone. How are we?
Oh, gosh,
that's a trick right there. First time. How's everyone doing? Good, good. Glad you guys are here. My name is Russell. I'm the lead pastor here at Mission City. We're so glad that you're joining us today. We are a community that makes Jesus known. We want to share Jesus. We want to know Jesus, and we want everyone to know him too. So we're super glad that you're here. On the screen right now is a QR code. And that QR code, you might not actually be able to see it with the lights on, so I apologize for that. So you might have to Google missioncitykc.com instead. But that QR code should take you to our website, or again, missioncitykc.com will bring you to our website. And then on our website's menu is something called the Connect Card. And we ask people that come to Mission City to fill out that Connect Card. One, for us to know that you are here, helps us to shepherd you well, because we're a small church. We want to engage with the people that are here, and that if you're not here, we want to know as well. But then two, if you're new, it's an opportunity for you to connect and reach out if you want to reach out to us. So no pressure there. But if you want more information about the church, or if you would like to have questions about what we believe, or want to even meet and have coffee with me and my wife and I, we'd love to do that with you as well. So you can do that there. You can also, if you're interested in serving, like we have a lot of serving opportunities coming. We always need serving opportunities with kids, connections like greeters and the welcoming team. If you're a musician, or maybe you see my man Soren back here, if you feel like you could do slides or want to do some audio stuff, you can potentially volunteer that way. And then a new thing that we're adding, two new things that we're kind of adding is, we have a setup team, but we're going to formalize that in the next few weeks. And then we're also formalizing a security team as well, just because the movie theater is, for most of our existence, has not been open when we're meeting for service. But now the theater is starting to be open because we're getting more and more back to normal. And so we're going in that way. So if you're interested in any of that, you could write the name of what I just said. I want to serve kids, or put security. And not that you're asking for security, but that you're that you're wanting to volunteer there. So you do that. Also on our website, you can give at missioncitykc.com/give. And then just a couple of things. One, this is kind of new for some people, but we take off 4th of July weekend because we are a load-in, load-out church. And so a part of that is we want to give a break to the people that load in and load out every single week. We do it twice a year. We usually do it the 4th of July weekend because it's a pretty natural flow and people are out of town anyway. And then also we do it the Sunday after Christmas. So those are spread out intentionally for our volunteers instead of love on them. Because if you load in, load out 50 weeks a year, you get tired of it. And so it's a way just to encourage them and for us to not meet. I might have like a little brief message online that you can watch if you want to. But there's that. Also, a couple other things too. There is a women's retreat the last month of July, and that's gonna be awesome. We've rented a big house. A mom's gonna come out and cook, or a lady's gonna come out and cook for the weekend, and you're gonna be going through the Book of Ruth, and it's gonna be quite incredible. And so if you're looking to get connected and you're a lady, this is a perfect opportunity for you. It starts Friday night at 7. I'm sure there'll be a later car that will go as well. It's only about 45 minutes away, so you can make that. It's $100. If that's too much, please talk to me about it, because we would love to support you in that, or at least help finance some of that for you, because we'd rather you go than not go as well. So I think that's all the announcements I have. So now we're going to jump into our series in the Book of Psalms. So we're going to turn me down just a smidge, if you don't mind. And it's probably my mic placement that I'm sure Tyler is upset about. So, so we're super glad that you guys are here. We've been in the Book of Psalms, and it's a great passage of scripture, or it's just a great book. It's one of my favorite books, but it's because it's so useful for us. It's something that's so useful for us. It's something that you can, even if you have very little understanding of the scriptures, it's something that you can connect to and relate to, because there's probably something in there for you. There's 150 psalms, individual psalms, that are written by different individuals, mostly attributed to David. It goes through different phases of life, of success, of praising when we're happy and God has come through, and in low times as well. So today we're actually going to talk about the sad psalms. I have to be careful because I could just say sad songs. So now I do want to take a poll, because we were talking about this before the service. How many of you are like happy song people? Like, you're just all about the happy songs? Like when you're in the radio, like when you turn the radio on, you're like the first thing you're going to, looking for the happy song. That's great. It's about half of you. Now how many of you are like, you know what, there's just something about the sad songs that just does something deep inside you. You know what I'm saying? It's like, yeah, like you would rather, yes, like you just need to, like I just need to feel something right now. And I don't cry, but when I turn on that one song, I just feel something new. You know what I mean? So, that's actually kind of, the psalms are divided up. There's more discrepancy to this, but for the most part, there's songs of praise, or I like to call them happy psalms. And then there's songs of lament, which are the sad psalms. And really the laments will outlast, or there's more of them in the Book of Psalms and in Scripture. But the Psalms of Praise, as you go and work your way through the Book of Psalms, you see an increase in the Psalms of Praise and a decrease in the Psalms of Lament. Because again, it's It's some of it's working through the history of the kingdom of Israel, who established this kingdom and then they went into exile, and then they hope for a future kingdom that will never end, that we believe is found and started with the person of Jesus and his death and resurrection. It's all pointing in that way as well. And so, but today we're going to spend specific times just looking at these sad psalms. And I don't know about you, but I grew up in a more of a tradition where you just kind of like Christianity or following Jesus, in some ways it wasn't okay to be sad. Like, you had to always be happy, and like, I do think we should always have joy because of what Christ has done, but it almost is like you weren't allowed to like you can only, I always have to twist it to like focus on either the faithfulness of God or the sovereignty of God or the love of God or God's in control of his plan. And I think you should eventually get there, but if you look at the book of Psalms and you look at the laments, these are people that are wrestling with this tension of like, there's brokenness in the world, and what do I do with that? And so that's what we're gonna look today. Now today's gonna be maybe a little bit more of a template for you, because it's going to allow you to, the points that I have are more of like, hey, if you want to lament with God over something, this is the steps that you do. We're not always a, hey, here's five things that you can do, and it's not going to fix your life. It's just, this is how Psalm 79 shows and models a lament. And so we're going to model maybe our laments as we go forward, and maybe you can try practicing this too. Also, I encourage you, the reason why we're doing this series is not so you're like, cool, I learned about the Psalms, it was great. Also, hey, like, I hope that you increase in your own personal prayer life or your own personal connection with God as you figure out how you're talking to God as well. And so sometimes, I think I ended last week talking about, like, sometimes we don't pray or sometimes we don't even journal because we don't know where to start or begin. And it's like, that's okay to be there, but it's not okay to stay there. And so let's grow in this. And if you're dealing with something, like maybe God wants you to work out how do you lament with the brokenness in this world. And maybe you're not dealing with something, but if you've lived long enough, you know eventually you will. And when it comes around, you now have this tool that you can process this as well. So, but it's interesting because this gives you permission in some ways to complain, to grieve, to struggle with life. And this is, and so for me, for me and my tradition, this is very foreign because it's like, I never got to actually like vent, you know what I mean? Like sometimes venting is helful. Now sometimes venting is hurtful, but it's almost like I've never got to vent. But the point of a lament is like, it's almost like I'm being able to vent to God about what's going on in your life. So let's look at this. The first part of this is just sharing your circumstance. That's the first step of lament, is that you actually can be honest with God about where you're at and how you're feeling and what's going on. You actually, in your own prayer life, can communicate together. If you're a journaler, if you're a talker, if you're a thinker, you can be honest with God about this. But the first step is you actually have to bring your circumstance to God. So share with God your circumstances. Psalm 79, verse 1 is this. O God, the nations have come into your inheritance. That's basically saying that the nations are coming into the promised land, and they're basically about to sin, or they have sinned. They don't have, there's not a time stamp on this psalm. Historians don't know when this was written, so, but there is a, it's about to go into exile because the Babylonians or the Assyrians have wrecked Jerusalem. So this, we see it. They have defiled your holy temple. They have laid Jerusalem in ruins. They have given the bodies of your servants to the birds of the air, or the birds of heaven for food. The flesh of your faithful to the beasts of the earth. They have poured out their blood like water all around Jerusalem. There was no one to bury them. We have become a taunt to our neighbors and mocked and derided by those around us. Pretty bad circumstances, yeah? I wouldn't want to live there. You know what I'm saying? What's going on? So nations have stolen their land. They have torn down their city. They have defiled the temple. City is in ruin. The people, they are left bodies for dead to be eaten by the birds and by the beasts of the earth. Now, I will say this, and the more time you spend with me, you'll learn that I think most of Scripture goes back to Genesis 1, 2, and 3. Like, there's connections to it. And so when you hear, when I hear the birds and the beasts, I think about God in creation, and I think about how God has created man to rule over the birds of the air and the beasts of the field. And now that they're crying out, or the psalmist that has written this is crying out and saying, when the birds are feasting on the humans, when the beasts are feasting on human bodies, that is not supposed to, that's not how this world's supposed to function. That's not how this is supposed to exist. There's something wrong with this. People are not being buried, and other neighboring nations are taunting them and mocking them and ridiculing them. And so, but we see this is what's going on. They're going into exile. Is what's about to happen. They've been captured. This city has been overtaken. And but for you, as you think about your life, as you think about your own, if you're going to lament at some time, if you need to process with God, I would say this, is that it begins with you sharing what's going on. And for me, I don't know who, I don't know you, I can speak for my own self, but I tend to suppress or push down my, like, what I'm thinking and what I'm feeling. It's just how I'm wired. It's very unhealthy. You shouldn't do that. But it's how I'm wired. And so, actually, recently, I've been trying to tell my wife, Cassidy, she's with the kids today, but I've been trying to tell her, I've been trying to share my feelings more. And she's like, what are you doing? Why are you sharing that? Because she's not used to it. We've been married for like 8 years, and she's like, I don't know what, I'm not used to this. She's like, I'm happy with this, but this is new, and I don't like it all the time. But I'm trying to get better at it, because sometimes I don't emote, like you can tell what I'm feeling, but I do feel things, maybe not as strongly as everyone else, but I do feel things. And a part of that is needing to share, like, so I feel them, I just don't share them, I feel them, and then I think, all right, how do I continue to act as plainly, whatever is possible, and I move on. And I remember one time there was a time I was sharing with our sending church's senior pastor, his name's Tim. I was sharing with him something that was going on, and then I was trying to process it. And his first question to me was like, he didn't like, hey, have you talked to this person about it, or have you asked any other people about it, or your wife about it? He said, have you shared this with God? And I was like, no, I haven't shared this with God. I'm sharing it with you, Tim. You're the pastor. Like, pastor me, come on. Like, I didn't think I needed, he knows everything. I don't need to share everything, which it's not, I'm not saying God isn't all-knowing, but there's this relational connection that exists between us and God, that God desires a relationship with us, and that and prayer is this opportunity to dialogue with God, and I am missing out on dialogue with God if I only sing praises to him when good things are happening. It's like, I should tell him about the struggle that I'm dealing with. I should tell him about this discontentment that I'm having. At that point, it was a discontentment about, I was in a job, God was preparing me to plant, I didn't know it yet, and I was trying to figure out, why did I feel this way? And but I needed to share that with God. And so share your circumstances this isn't complicated. It's just share your circumstances. So the next thing is, and I think this is kind of like this is a great cry if you're like, I need language for how to petition to God. And this is for number two, is just, so you share your connection. The second thing you do, or your circumstance, then you share your petition to God. Like, what are you asking for? So not only is, hey, what's going on, but like, what are you kind of wanting? And this one's very short. He says this in verse 5. He says, how long, O Lord, will you be angry forever? Will your jealousy burn like fire? How long is this going to last? You ever asked that to God before? How long? How long? How long is it going to be? Like, is it going, like, how long? The first thing that comes to my mind is, now my daughter is 5, and she has begun to ask the question of, are we there yet? Which is a very similar question in this, right? Because what you're asking for is, if it's whatever circumstance it is you're asking for God to take you and to magically move you from this space and move you over to this space. And we do that, right? Like, when challenge happens, when struggle happens, with whatever however long the season goes, is sometimes we desire to be past the season when God wants us to go through the season, and we're asking this question of how long. But we should ask the question, and we should petition to God and ask him to come through, and we should do this. But sometimes by asking how long, it doesn't mean it's going to be over like that. Sometimes it can be a quick and like God does come in and answer your prayer right away. Sometimes it can take a while. And this is not the fun one, but this is the one as a pastor I have to actually tell you, is that sometimes it won't be resolved until Jesus comes back. And that's the one that no one wants to hear, right? That's the one that no one wants to hear, but that's the truth, is that sometimes it won't be resolved until Jesus comes back. These people, the people that wrote this as they're thinking about the exile, probably in Babylon, is they did not, their kids did not, their kids' kids did not, but maybe a few generations beyond that, were able to come back to Jerusalem, and it still wasn't established completely as well. But that question of how long, and the other thing too is like, we don't stop saying that. We have hope in Jesus that he is going to come through. We have hope in Jesus that he is going to make things right. We have hope in Jesus that he can come through. But this is the language, this is how long, and that can be a devastating question. That could be a hard thing. But really, I would encourage you just to deeply, if you're like in a long season of waiting for something, like petition to God, share, lay out your circumstances and ask, how long, Lord? How long? Is it something I've done? Like, what is going on? How long? Then the third one is just share with God that you're an oppressor. Like, who is oppressing you? Now, it might not be, circumstance might have an oppressor, it might not. I don't know. It could be something else. But this is what the guy says in verse 7. He says, pour out your anger on the nations that do not know you. So like, hey, stop putting your anger on me, God. What about all those people who don't know you over there on the kingdoms that don't call upon your name? I'm calling upon your name. Like, why does it appear like they have favor with you, but I'm the one that's dealing with this? For they have devoured Jacob and laid waste his habitation, basically just destroying the land of Israel, is what they're talking about as well. But what about those who don't know you? What about those who don't follow you? Give anger to them. What about all of the other injustice in the world? God, do something in that. Have judgment in that. Don't have judgment on my life. And then the next one is just asking for compassion. I can't remember how I worded it, but the next one, how did I word that? Yeah, ask God for compassion. And this can be a sobering reality as well. Not only is it that, and this is why lamenting is helpful, is because like, we need to be honest with God. We need to be able to share, not just like, hey, you're a follower of Jesus, you need to be happy all the time. You need to be full of joy all the time. Yeah, sure, there's joy in Christ Jesus, and I can learn to be content in all circumstances, as Paul says, but also life is really hard sometimes, and sometimes I need to mourn. I need to be sad. I need to process. I need to be angry, and I need to process this with the Lord. But we need to ask him for his compassion, because the sobering reality is this sometimes, is that sometimes I am actually deserving of judgment. And some, maybe not even sometimes, maybe more than sometimes. Like, as human beings, we've all sinned. We've all have made mistakes. We've all done something to offend God, to dishonor God that is not of God. We've all offended other human beings. And sometimes the circumstance I am in is because of my own doing. Not always. Sometimes it's because someone has oppressed you. Sometimes it's a mixture of both. But like in this circumstance, the reason why Babylon comes in and sweeps them in, the reason why the Assyrians before the Babylonians did this, is because the people of Israel weren't following God. They weren't obeying the commandments of the Lord. And so God was not going to let his name be taken advantage of. And so he said, here is your punishment. You go into exile. I'm out. But sometimes we are responsible sometimes. And it's not to say that God isn't gracious or compassionate. It's just to say there are circumstances to life. There's circumstances to certain things. Maisie, we were watching Jake and Sarah's dog, and so Maisie, like, we have two dogs that are golden doodles, and Maisie just like tackles and does other stuff too. But Cooper's not used to having a kid around as much. But Maisie likes to pick him up and hold him down. And I'm like, if you hold a dog down that you don't know, you might get nipped at. The consequence of that is pretty clear. It's like the judgment of that is instantaneous, right? I don't have to discipline. It's like, I can tell you so many times, but you can cry at me all you want to, but that's not the dog's fault. That's your fault. And so for us as human beings, like, sometimes we're in circumstances that we're in that we're crying out to God in places that we have done. But the good news is, the good news is that knowing Jesus helps us in this area, because he has forgiven us of all of our iniquity and sin, and he has set us free by God's grace. But this is the verse 8 and 9. It says, do not remember against us our former iniquities. Let your compassion come speedily to meet us, for we are brought very low. Help us, O God of our salvation, for the glory of your name. Deliver us and atone us for our sins, for your name's sake. And so we've all done evil, but ask God like to forgive our former sins. And in Jesus, you have the ability to lean into his blood, for him to have compassion for you as well. Calling on God to be your deliverer for your salvation, and so that he will get fame for his deliverance, that in his atoning, in his delivering of you, that people will come to know Jesus, because the stories you might tell after of how God has come through for you as well. And so we need to plead with God's compassion. And also, this is a great time for us to repent of any wrongdoing that we've done, to change our minds and to go into the way of Jesus as well. So after that, first you state the circumstance. Next you share a petition. How long? Like, hey, is this going to last? Like, Lord, something needs to change here. This is bad. Almost like redirecting to the injustice in the world. There's more injustice in the world. God, punish that. Forgive me of what I've messed up. And then the fourth one is just to remind God. To remind God of what? In this context, it's to remind God of his name. And we'll talk about that in a second a little bit, but about how, for whatever reason, like God's name, like he wants to make sure that it is honored and well-respected among all of the nations. And so this is their plea. He says, why should the nations say, where is their God? Let the avenging of the outpoured blood of your servants be known among the nations before our eyes. Let the groans of the prisoners come before you according to your great power. Preserve those doomed to die. Return sevenfold into the lap of our neighbors in taunts of which they have taunted you, O Lord. So why should the nations say, where's your God? Like, hey, going back to verse 9, he says, help us, O God of our salvation, for your glory of your name. But what happens is when God's chosen people get put into a low place, the nations are going to say to God, where are you, God? Like, where are you? Like, why is this happening to God's people? Why is this happening to the one true God's people? And again, like I said earlier, God cares about this. God doesn't want his name to be dishonored. God wants his name to be made known and wants everyone to glorify his name, because he's worthy of all of that as well. And don't let our enemies say, where is their God? Don't let the enemies have the ability to win in this moment. Like, where other gods have been absent, you, God, are present. And instead, let your avenging love be made known throughout the nations, because you have taken care of. And even though we disobey, we receive your forgiveness, and we receive that it's in you. Deliver us, though. And those that are supposed to die, God, rescue them. And those that are, show judgment to those that are provoking you and them as well. And so in your own petition, if you will, I would say remind God of those things. And it's one of those things. And there's other things that God, like his name matters, his promises. Like if there's a promise in the Old Testament, or you feel like God is speaking something to you, remind God of his promises. Remind God of his character. There's a passage in Ephesians 20 where God actually says his character, like describes his own himself, and you can remind him of who he is. And that's a huge thing. Like, as you're petitioning to God, I'm trying to decide if I want to share this, but I will. So Cass and I have been trying to have a baby for quite some time. And something I've been trying to incorporate in my own reminding of God is, and we have a child, by the way, we have one, so we're very thankful for that. But we want another, and something I've been reminding of God is reminding him that he has called human beings to be fruitful and multiply. And like that's a human like thing that he has called all human beings to be. And so something in my own lamenting, if you will, over the last, you know, months and years has been, Lord, you've called us to be fruitful and multiply. And so, like, you've said to human beings to do this. This is what you've created human beings to do, and we're not doing it. So what's up with that? And it's one of those things where it's, and you might say, well, why do I have to remind God? Right? Like, God knows everything. Why do I have to remind God? I don't know. Honestly, I don't know why. Like, that's an interplay. I don't know, but I do know it's a pattern in Scripture where we see, we talked a little bit about it last week, about how the righteous one, not that I'm righteous, but like God's people have permission to remind God of his character. Moses does it when he's on the mountain as God wants to kill all of the Israelites for worshiping the golden calf. Moses is like, yeah, but what, he actually leans on his name at that point. He says, well, what will the nation say about you? And again, because God had promised, this is my people, and this is the covenant that he has with them. And God wants to honor his promises. And so I don't know what you're longing for God to do or change, or what you're asking how long for, or I don't know if maybe you're not even asking that, but when you get to that point, is reminding God of his name, of his promises, of his character, and also of reminding of who you are in Jesus, that you now are forgiven son or daughter of the King of Kings, who is a new creation, who is now a witness of Jesus, death and resurrection to the world around you, crying out to people to come back to him. So, and then the last one is this, is that most laments, not all laments, but most laments, they finish with God's faithfulness and his loyalty, and then your loyalty to him. But you finish with the faithfulness of God, and you'll notice that, like, they'll say this, they'll be basically venting, and like, where are you, God, and how long, oh God, and why is this happening, and can you come through and deliver me, and all these different things. And then typically, not always, but typically they end like verse 13 does, where it says this: but we, your people, the sheep of your pasture, will give thanks to you forever from generation to generation. We will recount your praise. And it's almost like in this moment, like, hey, I'm just going to lay all of this out there. I'm just going to sit this right here for you, God. I'm just going to let you know, like, where I'm at. Like, I'm just going to place this just right in front of you, because this is really hurting me right now. This is really painful right now. This is really hard right now. And I know I'm a part of the problem, but forgive me in that. But I'm just going to put this in front of you. But at the same time, once I've sat down my complaint, once I've laid down my lament, I not only am I going to remind you of your promises, not only am I going to remind you of your character, of your name, but I also am going to remember who you are. I also am going to remember that you are God and that I am not, and I'm going to remember that you are faithful, that you are gracious, that you are full of mercy, and I am going to trust you for that. And sometimes, and I'll be honest with you, sometimes I can't get there the first day. You know what I mean? And it's not wrong. It's not wrong. It's just at some point, we have to get back to us remembering God's character. Like, sometimes I can be so frustrating and so mad or so sad or so in a place of mourning where, and they do that in the Psalms too, where they don't finish with the praise line. They just end. They're like, where are you? And sometimes, but most of the time they don't. And so for you, as you practice this, and I would encourage you to practice this, because this could be a freeing thing where you're learning to dialogue with God. You're learning to share with God what's going on, not just in the good things, not just celebrating the high moments, but sitting with Jesus in the low moments. And let me tell you something, he will be there with you. He will be there with you, and he will walk, like you might just love God in the mountaintop moments of your life, but in between peaks, when you're sitting in the valleys, and it's a long valley, and you can't even see the next range yet, Jesus is walking with you, and he is faithful, and that's why we praise him. And sometimes we remind God so that we can be reminded of who he is, and then we praise him for that. But again, it might take you a day, it might take you a week, it might take you a month. But our heart eventually will be changed, because we are going through this process of lamenting, of sharing our circumstances, of petitioning, of showing them who our oppressors is if we have one, of asking for compassion, of reminding God, and then eventually finishing with his faithfulness, because he is faithful to come through. And again, like I said, hopefully it will be done sooner than later, but sometimes it won't be finished until Jesus comes back. Would you pray with me? So Lord Jesus, thank you so much that you are faithful. And God, give us a space where we can lament. Give us a space where we can just pour out our hearts to you. And if we're in a good place or a bad place, in a safe space, if it's been a long time, whatever else it might be, but God, that we can be honest with you, and we know that you hear us and that you love us. And so God, would you move in this space, and also maybe give us permission, God, or allow, give us permission to be freed up to communicate, to express where we currently are with you. We love you so much. Praise in Jesus' name. Amen. So as we finish today, we have a couple more songs left, but we have a time of response. And in that time of response, there's a couple ways that you can do that. Number one, you'll notice there are communion cups, individual cups, that are down front. And so we take communion every single week to remember of why that we are able to approach God in this way, that we can have this dialogue with him in this way, because Jesus made a way for that through his body broken, his bloodshed for us. And so as you're ready, you can come down front with the people you're with, or if you want to do it on your own, depending on how this sermon has hit you today, that's fine as well. And take the elements when you're ready. It's a celebration and remembrance of our Savior and our King, body broken, bloodshed for you. Also, if you need prayer, let's say you are going through a hard time right now, you're in a season of lamenting, then we have two people that will be on either side of the aisle that would love to pray with you as well. And I also just want to encourage you, like, if this is something that you're like in a place where you're like, how long are we there yet? If you're there, because I know that can be, think about a kid like waiting to get home and they're asking how long. It's painful for them, you know what I mean? And it's painful for you too. And if you're there, and maybe you take our response time, and maybe you actually journal a little bit yourself what you're lamenting. Maybe you communicate with God for the first time and share, like, he knows, but maybe it's just like you share how you're feeling about this, or how you're feeling about that. Maybe you need to petition to him and ask him to come. Maybe you need to ask for his compassion and forgiveness. Maybe you need to remind him of his promises, his character, his name. Maybe you need to remember yourself so that when you lift your voice and praise him, you're acknowledging him for his faithfulness and his love and his grace. So we're going to take the time of response. If you're able, if you would stand with us as we sing. Again, move about as you need to. Communion, prayer team. If you need to sit and journal, that's fine too. But if you'd like to stand as we continue in worship, please do so. Thank you.
power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death or resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I can't.
Behind these words as we lift them up to you, Lord. Thank you.
stop now.
Today, if there's anything we can do for you, please reach out. We hope you have a fantastic week. Just